7:43 in Washington. Wow, 17 minutes before midnight and 17 minutes before my end of ringing with the quiet storm here at WHUR Radio.
You didn't even have to have a radio in D.C. All you had to do was open the window. You couldn't help but hear the quiet storm. That's how popular it was. It was the air that D.C. breathed.
The quiet storm was a nice slowdown where you can just listen to music and just kind of just escape and just vibe out.
For Melvin, the quiet storm was all about the music. It was not personality radio. It was all about his music.
If Phyllis Hyman was on, Melvin was in love. If Barbara Streisand was on, they done broke up.
Melvin was very classy, suave. You know, he was just top shelf. And you felt that even if you never met him.
He was so gracious and so sweet, and I was just so smitten because he was so handsome and that smooth voice.
I mean, he was the quiet storm epitomized.
He was an influencer before today's meeting for that term.
When you are with people every night, you create moods, especially night moods. I've always worked mornings, so I don't make babies. But Melvin was making babies at night. How could that not last in your memory forever? He was a part of your love life.
HUR came on the air in 1971, December 10th, 1971. And if you really put that in a historical context, you think about coming out of the 60s, 68, Dr. King dies, you know, U Street is on fire, and you start to go into the Black Power movement. And so if you think about this radio station owned by Howard University, one of the, you know, most powerful universities for Black folks in the country, and now they have these airwaves to be able to tell our stories.
Black radio was the way we got our information, the way we communicated with one another, the way we learned about what was going on in the neighborhood. There was no social media back then. We didn't have cell phones then. So we listened to the radio. When I arrived at Howard University, there was sort of a racial reawakening. Students were coming into their own. They were proud again to be Black and to express their Blackness. You know, people were sort of feeling like things were coming back together. The racial tensions were calming down. So it was a better time. DC was just getting home rule.
It was really magical at that time. Young Black professionals everywhere. We went out. There was a new place to hang out called the Foxtrot. And it just so happened that my husband and I, our first apartment together once we were married was right up the street from the Foxtrot. We lived on 16th Street, but right near it. And everyone would be at the Foxtrot, all the who's who in Washington and anyone who was anyone that came to town, where Black folks all got together. Everything was just wonderful in this city.
And that's when he was given like the charge by Kathy Hughes, go home, get some of your music and come back and play. And his engineer at the time was another friend of his who was like very familiar with like working the boards, Jack Schuler. And Jack was like Melvin's engineer or producer. And Melvin was like the person you heard cracking the mic.
Soft and warm, a quiet storm, quiet as wind flies.
Smokey Robinson's Quiet Storm, when you heard that melody, you knew, oh, it's time for Melvin Lindsey. It's time to stop. Dinner should be done. You should be in your night clothes or doing whatever you're gonna do at night, but it all had to stop because the Quiet Storm was the star of the show until midnight.
Hello, I'm Melvin Lindsey. Welcome to The Quiet Storm. 4 hours of my favorite songs presented for your enjoyment. Relax and enjoy. The Quiet Storm.
Well, you know, after first telling him to, when he would want to play the 45s, the records at home. My friends and I would tell him, go upstairs, get out of our way. And you know, like, they would say to me, why is he always wanting to spin records? And then, you know, lo and behold, this voice comes up on the radio, and I say to my mother, Moms, wait a minute, what is he doing? But you know, we were all just carried away. I couldn't believe it. This little kid brother, who I was always telling to get out of my hair, was moving up.
I just love someone who can create a vibe through music. You know, I'm a music man, and Melvin was a music man. And you felt that. You know, I can remember many nights, me and Pam, we would drive to the Bay to have dinner at Hemingway's and watch the sunset, and then riding back, we'd listen to Melvin. God, I miss those days. That was just the coolest night, driving back from the Bay, listening to Melvin, watching him paint, ear watching.
The next couple of songs I'm gonna play have a lot of meaning for me, and I want you to listen to the words. They're dedicated from me to you, and then I'll be back to say something else before I go. But listen to these, they're just for you.
The Quiet Storm started sort of a music revolution at WHUR. There was no place really that you could just listen to slow jams all night long. But you know, I guess people were in the mood for romance. The format just took you on this slow, smooth ride through the evening with Melvin Lindsey as the host, barely speaking, but mixing and blending and segueing those songs to the point where it was so subtle you didn't even realize when the songs were changing. You would never hear his voice. For Melvin, The Quiet Storm was all about the music. It was not personality radio. It was all about his music.
Melvin played the music he wanted to play depending on the mood he was in when he came to work that day. If he came to work and he was sad, he was going to make you sad. If he came happy, he was going to uplift you in his music.
Love has finally come at last. Music from Patti LaBelle on Super 96. WHUR, before that, we heard one of my favorites from Patti, If Only You Knew Just How Much I Love You. Scott Jarrett, and that's a tune we always get a lot of calls from. It's The Image of You. It's from an album Without Rhyme or Reason from Scott Jarrett. Hold On to the World from Peebo Bryson, and Tonight I Celebrate My Love for You.
They were appreciative that Melvin played their music because there was nobody else in the city playing that kind of music.
The best on-air personalities and disc jockeys do not have control over the music that's played. A station owner will tell you that their FCC license is too important to give that responsibility to the person who's playing the records. And they don't allow it. They don't allow their air talent to have creative control. There's one deal point that I was very steadfast in negotiating, and that was that Melvin Lindsey had to have creative control over the music that he played.
Melvin created something here that just took off, and it's taken off across the country. You almost can't go to a city and not find a Quiet Storm.
This is The Quiet Storm.
He was truly a part of the community. I mean, he'd go to high schools and speak, colleges. He'd do things for African-American organizations. And that's how basically he got popular. I don't think it was the radio show. I think it was his involvement in the community that made him popular.
Melvin just loved Southwest. She loved DC.
The condominium that Melvin owned that my grandparents lived in was right above us. This would be the hub where everyone visited.
Second one up from the top.
Wow.
Yeah, you want to be out there playing. God, what a difference. He wouldn't believe Southwest now, would he?
I guess growing up, he kind of guided me, you know? So he was my uncle who I knew on the radio, but he also was like the uncle I knew who also was very supportive and just loving of what I was into as well.
Yeah, I mean, everybody always said he was just so easy you know, he didn't act like I'm a, don't come near me.
Right.
He really reached out to folks.
He wasn't pretentious. He left here and got a $1 million contract at a time when that wasn't happening a lot. But he didn't carry it like that. He was still a Howardite, your friend, a Washingtonian, you know, who happened to be on the radio every night. But he took his business very, very seriously.
First of all, you could not beat Melvin Lindsey. You couldn't beat him. I mean, really, it's just a concession. It's like, we're going to try to beat you during the rest of the day, but this guy, you just can't beat. So I decided I wanted to hire him.
And wow, I've got to take a deep breath before I do this. It's been 9 years I've been here with The Quiet Storm at WHUR. And if you haven't heard by now, this is my last night. At midnight, it's sign off and sign out.
Melvin loved Howard University. He loved WHUR. But sometimes radio can be a short-lived career, although Donnie Simpson certainly has written the book another way. It was a very lucrative and a well-deserved, you know, he was getting what he deserved contract.
There was always a huge discrepancy in pay between blacks and whites in this industry. And from a very early age, that bothered me. And I felt like that was part of my charge, was to correct that. At that time, morning men were making, you know, like getting $1 million over 5 years. That's for the morning show, top morning shows in this city. I gave that to Melvin to do nights. That was unheard of. Most people were making a quarter of that. But he was the only person that I could do that for, and I know that they're not gonna bark at it. Management, you know, we're too successful. You know, what I tell them to do, they're going to do. They're going to write that check. So I'm in a position to do that. And so Melvin had that level of significance to me and to us in correcting that pay scale. He was significant.
There was a television show I was doing in Baltimore. And when I was auditioning for it on Channel 13, I was, you know, it was down to me and another young lady. And the producer said, let me just bring you in and test with the guy that we think we're going to hire. And I walk in and it's Melvin Lindsey. And we both just crack up because we had already been friends. They didn't even know we knew each other. You know, so we started working together on that show. And then they put us together to co-host Screen Scene on BET. We were just so close and such good friends. We'd work together Monday through Friday at BET doing a live television show. On Thursdays, we'd do the show for WJZ in Baltimore. But then we'd hang out on the weekends. We were together almost every single day of our lives.
He loved his listeners, and he loved this city, and he loved this university. He loved this university. He said that it would always be, and that his listeners and that Howard would always be part of his life.
I want to thank all of you. Most importantly, you have been good to me for 9 years. You have respected me. You've been tuning in consistently to hear what I have to say. When I've emceed concerts, you've been polite to me. If I'm in a grocery store, a department store, you come up and you tell me how much I mean to you on the radio. And thank you so much. God bless all of you.